Biblical Talks podcast with Michael Tolliver. This podcast is dedicated to biblical teaching and having worldview discussions from a biblical perspective. Here is today's podcast.
Beloved, let's look at Romans chapter 9, starting at verse 13. As it is written, Jacob I love, but Esau I hated. For what shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. For he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. So then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God, who has mercy. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I have raised you up, that I may show my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So then he has mercy on whoever he wills, and he hardens whoever he wills. You said to me then, why does he still find fault? For who can resist his will? But who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Will what is mold say to its molder, why have you made me like this? Has the potter no right over the clay to make out the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? Beloved, this is a very controversial text, but we're going to see that God is sovereign. Beloved, when we say that God is sovereign, what do we mean by this expression? What we are saying is that God rules. To say that God is sovereign is to pronounce that God is God and we are not. Arthur Pink said in his book, The Sovereignty of God, to say that God is sovereign is to declare that he is the Most High, doing according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, so that none can stay his hand or say unto him, what dost thou? To say that God is sovereign is to declare that he is the Almighty, the possessor of all power in heaven and earth, so that none can defend him, defeat him. None can be his counsel. None can prevent his purpose or resist his will. To say that God is sovereign is to declare that he is the governor among the nations, setting up kingdoms, defeating empires, and determining the courses of destinies and dynasties as pleasing and pleasant to himself. To say that God is sovereign is to declare that he is the only potentate, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Such is the God of the Bible. That's Arthur Pink. Beloved, as much as we would like to believe that we are in full obedience to the sovereignty of God, all of us have areas in our lives that we have fended off, as though God could be sovereign in some areas of our life, but not in others. Most Christians profess to believe in the sovereignty of God, but will complain and grumble in certain areas. Death is usually assigned to the category of God's sovereignty because we have no control over death at all. Disasters are considered a matter of divine sovereignty, with even unbelievers referring to certain disasters as acts of God. Most evangelicals refuse to grant God sovereignty when it comes to salvation of sinners. Somehow he's not sovereign when it comes to a person being born again. They are willing to grant God much of the credit for the work of Christ on the cross and the Holy Spirit working, drawing man to faith. But they are not willing to admit God is in complete control. For this is precisely what sovereignty is, complete control. Granted, man have a role to play in this process, but clearly God is in control, complete control of the process. Now, this debate over the relationship between God's role in salvation and man's may seem to be reserved for academics only, but this is not true. For the sovereignty of God in salvation is a most critical doctrine, as Martin Luther claimed, and I quote, "Therefore, it is not irrelevant, intrusive, or trivial, but helpful and necessary for a Christian to find out whether the will does anything or nothing in the matter pertaining to eternal salvation. If we do not know these things, we shall know nothing at all of things Christian and shall be worse than any heathen. Therefore, let anyone who does not feel this confess that he is not a Christian. For I am ignorant of what, how far, and how much I can may do in relationship to God. It would be equally uncertain and unknown to what, how far, and how much God can and may do in me. But when the works and the power of God are unknown in this way, I cannot worship, I cannot praise, I cannot thank and serve God. Since I do not know how much I ought to attribute to myself and how much to God, it is therefore behooves us to be very certain about the distinction between God's power and our own, God's work and our own, if we want to live a godly life." That's Martin Luther. What does it mean when we say that God is sovereignty and salvation? Charles Spurgeon said it this way about God's sovereignty and salvation: "If any man be saved, he is saved by divine grace, and by divine grace alone. The reason of his salvation is not to be found in him, but in God. We are not saved as the result of anything that we do or that we will, but we will and do as a result of God's good pleasure and the work of his grace in our hearts. No sinner can prevent God. That is, he cannot go before him. He cannot anticipate him. God is always first in the matter of salvation. He is before our convictions, before our desires, before our fears, and before our hopes. All that is good or ever will be good in us is preceded by the grace of God and is the effect of a divine cause within. Again, the grace of God is sovereign. By that we mean that God has an absolute right to give that grace where he chooses, and to withhold it when he pleases. He is not bound to give it to any man, much less to all men. If he chooses to give it to one man and not to another, his answer is thine eyes evil because my eye is good? Can I not do as I will with my own? I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy." That's Charles Spurgeon. Beloved, let's make this clear. God is sovereign, even in our salvation. Scripture says the same thing. All scripture says the same thing. There are so many scriptures we can quote to this and see the sovereignty of God, just as clearly and forcefully as we just heard and read by Charles Spurgeon. Let's look at some scriptures now and see God is sovereign even in our salvation. "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draw him, and I will raise him up on the last day." John 6:44. "And he was saying, for this reason I have said to you, that no one can come to me unless he has been granted, unless it has been granted from the Father." John 6:65. And when the Gentile heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord. And as many as had been appointed to eternal life believe. Acts 13:48. Are you getting the point? Okay. A certain woman named Linda from the city of Thyatira, a seller of purple fabrics, a worshiper of God, was listening. And the Lord opened her heart to respond to the things spoken by Paul. Acts 16:14. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who became his counselor, or who has first given him that he might be paid back to him again? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. Romans 11:34-36. By his doing, you are in Christ, who became to us wisdom from God and the righteousness and sanctification and redemption. That just as it is written, let him who boasts boast in the Lord. 1 Corinthians 1:30-31. For I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in me will perfect it unto the day of Jesus Christ. Philippians 1:6. He saved us, not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy, by the washing of the regeneration or renewing by the Holy Spirit. Titus 3:5. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Hebrews 12:2. Listen, beloved, are you getting the point? Those who are saved because God has chosen them for salvation. The Holy Spirit has given life to a dead spirit, and he has given understanding to a mind that was blinded by sin and by Satan. Those who are saved may say, I chose God, but only after God has chosen them for salvation. John 15:16 says this, if you did not choose me, but I have chosen you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. Now, the other side of this equation is also true. Listen, beloved. Those who are eternally lost are lost because God has not chosen them for salvation. Isaiah 6:8-10 says this. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, who shall I send? And who will go for us? Then I said, here I am, send me. And he said, go and tell this people, keep on listening, but do not perceive. Keep on looking, but do not understand. Render the hearts of this people unmoved, for their ears are dull and their eyes dim, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and return and be healed. Revelation 13:3-8 says this. And I saw one of his head as if it had been slain, and his fatal wound was healed. And the whole earth was amazed and followed after the beast. And they worshiped the dragon because he gave his authority to the beast. And they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like the beast? And who is able to wage war with him? And there was given to him a mouth speaking conceited words and blasphemies. And authority to act for 42 months was given to him. And he opened his mouth in blasphemies against God, and to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle, that is, those who dwell in heaven. And it was given to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and the authority over every tribe and people and tongue and nation was given to him. And all those who dwell on the earth will worship him. Listen to this. Everyone whose name has not been written from the foundation of the world in the book of life of the Lamb who was slain. who has been slain. Revelation 13, 3 through 8. In Revelation chapter 17, verse 8, it says, "The beast that you saw was and is not, and is about to come up out of the abyss and to go to destruction. And those who dwell on the earth will wonder, whose name has not been written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they see the beast that he was and is not and will come." Beloved, please don't misunderstand what is being said here. In order to be saved, man must trust in Jesus Christ as God's provision to save lost sinners. And when they do that, it's because God has given them the heart to do so. Man exercises faith out of the heart of God has given them to believe. In other words, "For by grace have you been saved through faith. And this is not of your own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so no one can ever boast." Ephesians 2, 8 through 9. Okay, let's look at this verse. Let's look at verse 13. "As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated." This is a quotation from the last book in the Old Testament, Malachi 1, verses 2 through 3. Paul here makes the distinction between natural and grace, between Israel after the flesh and after the spirit. He runs up the subject to the fountainhead of the appointment. And in the everlasting purpose, counsel, will, and pleasure of Jehovah, he shows how the church was chosen in Christ from the beginning. And the church contributed nothing to it because the thing was done before the foundation of the world, and it was done before they was born. A student once said to Dr. Griffin Thomas that he was having problems. He was having trouble with this passage, with this text, because he could not understand why God hated Esau. Dr. Thomas answered, "I'm having a problem with this text too, but mine's a little different." He says, "I don't understand why God loves Jacob. That's my big problem. It's easy to see why God rejected Esau. He was a rascal. He was a godly fella, filled with pride. And from him came the nation that wanted to live without God and turn their backs on God. Now, I can understand why God rejected Esau, but why he chose Jacob? That's the question. The Bible tells us that he made his choice according to his sovereign will. In verse 14, Paul raised this question. What shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. Paul raised a question which he expects a negative response. There is no injustice with God, is there? Listen, beloved. Paul's response makes it very clear. Paul says, "May it never be." I prefer the old translation of the King James Version, which King James Version said, "God forbid." Of course, God is free from anyone accusing him of injustice. If this question presupposes the answer, it also presupposes the reason for asking it. Paul is teaching divine election. God chooses one and rejects another one. And when God chooses a person for salvation, he always does it on the basis of his grace, bestowing by his sovereign choice and not on the basis of works. If Paul were not teaching the doctrine of election, the question would be inappropriate because it's not even a desire. It doesn't even desire an answer because it's not the issue. But Paul was teaching on election, which is why he raises the question of justice. But Lord, let's keep in mind that in this universe, it's God's universe. It's his universe. He is sovereign. We are but little creatures on earth. He could take away the breath from us at any moment now. This very next second, the breath could be gone. So the question is, do I have the boldness to stand on my 2 feet, look him in the face, and question what he does? That would be rebellion of the worst sort. I bow to my Creator and my Redeemer, knowing that whatever choices that he makes, it's right. It's the right choice. By the way, if you don't like what he does, perhaps you need to move out of his universe and start your own universe, and you can make all the rules you want to make. But as long as you and I live in God's universe, we have to play according to his rules. Man needs to bow his stiff neck and stubborn knees before the God Almighty and say to him, "There is no unrighteousness with thee." Listen. In verse 15, this is what he says, Paul says. Once again, he's going back to the Old Testament. "For he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." Moses, you recall, wanted to see God's glory. God said, in effect, "I show you it to you, Moses, but I'm not showing it to you because you are Moses." Now, Moses was a very important person. He was leading the children of Israel through the wilderness. God said, "I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion, and I will do this for you, not because you are Moses, but because I'm God." Do you know why God saved me? It was not because my name is Michael Tolliver. He did not save you because of your name. He saved you because he is God. He made the choice. And that's the only reason why you are saved today. And that should make you shout hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Beloved, listen to me. How then can God choose to save one and harden another and not be accused of injustice? The answer is very simple. It's grace. Listen to me. Salvation is a matter of divine grace, sovereignly given to those who God chose as his beneficiary. Grace is about something wonderful which God gives to the guilty sinner who are not worthy of God's blessing. Justice is about people getting what they deserve. It is unjust when man labor for their employer and are not paid. It is unjust when a guilty criminal is not punished. God is not unjust to condemn sinners to eternal torment because they are getting just what they deserve. Also, God is not unjust in saving men. Listen, the punishment for sinners who God has saved in Jesus Christ, Jesus paid for the sinner's sin when he died in the sinner's place, bearing the wrath of God. God is therefore just in condemning man to bear the penalty they deserve. And he's just in saving man whose penalties Christ has paid for. Listen to me. None other human race deserves this favor. And he has the right to pardon who he pleases and to save people on his own terms and according to his sovereign will and pleasure. Listen, in the 1647 Westminster Confession, listen to this. They are talking about the effectual call. "All those who God has predestinated unto life, and those only he is pleased, in his appointment and accepted time, effectually to call by his word and spirit out of that state of sin and death, in which they are by nature to the grace and salvation by Jesus Christ, enlightening their minds spiritually and savingly to understand the things of God, taking away their heart of stone and giving unto them an heart of flesh, renewing their wills, and by his almighty power determine them to that which is good, effectually drawn them to Jesus Christ. Yet so, as they come most freely, being made willingly by his grace. Again, that is the Westminster Confession of the Effectual Calling. So in verse 16, Paul says, so then it depends not on the will of man nor his exertion, but on God, who has mercy. The King James says it this way. So then it's not of him that willeth, nor him that runneth, but of God that shows mercy. So salvation is not ultimately based on human free will or some human effort, but only on God's merciful will. Beloved, even our faith is a gift of God, according to Ephesians 2:8-9. Listen, God's mercy is not extended as a recognition of human will, nor is it a reward of human works. If a man thinks that his decision and his effort cause God to look upon him with favor, he is highly deluded and he's highly delusional. God extends mercy, and he does it because he is God. Who are we to question him? Let me conclude with this. Anyone who is a child of God, it's not a child of God because they said a little prayer. Or someone who wishes their loved one would believe and be saved. Or someone who grew up in a particular home and was born into a particular family. Anyone who is born again is righteously because God chose them. Not by the judgment, hopes, or wishes of men, but by the will and wisdom of God and God alone. For Abraham judged that the blessing should, that he desired, might go to Ishmael. Isaac also willed and planned that his firstborn Esau to have the blessing. Esau wishing and hoping that it might be his, so he went and ran and hunted for some red meat that he might have the blessing bestowed upon him. They all were disappointed. Arthur Pink says this. God has ordained to eternal life certain ones. In due time, believe that God's ordination to salvation of his own elect is not due to any good thing in them, nor to anything worthy from them, but solely on of his grace. That God intentionally selected the most unlikely objects to be the heirs of his special favor, in order that no flesh should glory in his presence. That God chose his people in Christ before the foundation of the world, not because they were so, but in order that they should be holy and without blame before him. That having selected certain ones to salvation, he also decreed that means by which his eternal counsel should be made good, that the very grace by which we are saved was in God's purpose, given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, that long before they were actually created, God elect stood present before his mind, were foreknown by him, and were surely object of his eternal love. That is great. That's from Arthur Pink. Beloved, this is the reality. God chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world. We are saved not because of what we do, who we know. We are saved because he chose us. And if you're part of the elect, you are a very blessed person. Not because of anything you've done, but because of what he has done for you. We're going to pick this up next time in verse 17. Have a blessed day.
Thank you for listening to Biblical Talks. This podcast is solely supported by listener donations. Please go to biblicaltalks.com to support this podcast and have a blessed day.